Respected teachers, dear students and friends, hearty namaste to all of you, and I welcome you to today's discussion on pharmacogenomics. It's a presentation on pharmacogenomics. Myself, I'm Swanand, and I'm professor of pharmacology, and we will be dealing with the aspects, various aspects of pharmacogenomics. Rather, I will call it as an introduction towards the pharmacogenomics, because pharmacogenomics is such a vast topic that we have conferences that are being conducted for pharmacogenomics under the arena of pharmacogenomics. So it's a very vast topic. Today what we will be seeing will be only an introduction towards the pharmacogenomics. Pharmacogenomics, let us see what's the meaning of this particular word, pharmacogenomics. It has om in it. Om in Hindu philosophy stands for completeness. It is completeness of something. Completeness of what? Completeness of the genes. So genome is something. Genome, it has a word genome in it. Genome is something. When we take all the genes of a particular organism together, we call it as the genome. And what it is? Pharmacogenomics. How the knowledge of this genome can be utilized in pharmacology for development of new drugs as well as new treatment modalities, that is what we will be discussing under pharmacogenomics. So this is how we mean pharmacogenomics. So when we combine the drugs and gene, for that matter genome, we say that when we combine all the genes together of a particular organism of in a cell, it is called as genome. You must be very familiar with the word Human Genome Project. And when that knowledge of that genome, the knowledge of that gene is combined with the knowledge of the drugs for the better development of drugs and therapeutics, we call it as pharmacogenomics. There are two words altogether. First is pharmacogenetics and second is pharmacogenomics. What we mean by pharmacogenetics? Study of variation in the single gene. When there is a variation in the single gene, we call it as pharmacogenetics. And pharmacogenomics, study of effect of variations in multiple genes. Obviously, we said that collection of all the genes in a particular organism, we call it as genome. So we have pharmacogenomics and pharmacogenetics. They generally go hand in hand, and sometimes they are being used interchangeably as well. But here we will be using the term pharmacogenomics rather than the pharmacogenetics. What's the need? What's the need of pharmacogenomics? What's the need of combining the knowledge of pharmacogenomics with pharmacology? Let us see that. Let us see a scenario here, and then we will automatically come to know what is the need for it. Metoprolol in MI patients. Now this is a scenario for metoprolol in MI patient. Metoprolol is used in post MI to prevent further cardiac damage. We all know that. The observation was made at the Asian patients require 65% less of the dose even when weight is corrected than Caucasians. So this was the observation. We tend to say that one dose fits all, but this is not the case. The observation was made that Asian patients require 65% less of a dose, and 65% is a significant thing. Coming to this, metoprolol exposure with equal weight dose reduced metabolism in Asians. 10 Cochs and 6 Asians took metoprolol daily for 5 days. Asians have substantial increase in the metoprolol area under the curve. Metoprolol is substantially increased in the case of what? The Asians as compared to the Caucasians, as you can see here. Asians, and that led to Asians having more toxicity towards like bradycardia and hypotension of metoprolol. Probably why this happened? Because the metabolism of metoprolol was retarded, was slow in the case of Asians as compared to the Caucasians. That is why. Second scenario, we are seeing the need of pharmacogenomics. Second scenario of HIV patients. Three drug regime is the therapy of choice for HIV infection. That is HAART therapy. That also we know well. Protease inhibitors provide the most active anti-HIV drugs. The anti-HIV drugs of promise are protease inhibitors. Continued viral suppression is related to adequate drug exposure. When we have adequate drug exposure, we have the viral suppression. That also we know. Now see this particular scenario. 24 years male with HIV disease started on HAART therapy with Indinavir. Now Indinavir is the drug that we will be studying, and it was a protease inhibitor. Patient's viral load responded with well, with the drop from 1 lakh to 50 copies per ml of HIV. Patient was depressed. Obviously, if anybody is being detected as HIV positive, the person will be depressed, and there is nothing new in that. And this patient was also depressed. What was started? What? St. John's wort. We know that this helps in a kind of help is provided in the case of depression, and advice from the internet and website. In next visit, 4 weeks later, viral load was 50,000 copies. Suddenly, the phenotype of HIV shows IDV, that is Indinavir resistance. Why this happened? Why this happened at all? It's a very interesting case altogether. So what was done? A clinical trial was conducted with St. John's wort, decrease Indinavir, Cytravir concentrations. 8 healthy subjects took Indinavir along with St. John's wort for 2 weeks. And what was observed? St. John's wort reduced the Indinavir area under curve in these subjects. As you can see, Indinavir alone, you see the concentration of Indinavir. And here is a Indinavir with St. John's wort, and you see the concentration of Indinavir. Because the metabolism of Indinavir was increased because of the St. John's wort. And the study was published in Lancet 2000. Now, present scenario in the drug therapy, how the present scenario is there? Optimal therapy for major illness, it is still elusive. Major illnesses, we say that we can contain those, but we cannot cure it. Schizophrenia, around 30% of the drugs do not respond. Hypertension, only 27% adequately controlled. And ADR, 1 lakh patients die every year, and that is the statistics from USA, in USA. Cost of drug development, around $500 to $700 million for each drugs, and it is a fact that 80% fail in the clinical trial. So this is a present scenario of drug therapy, not so much encouraging in itself. So what is the conventional drug development approach? One size fits all approach. So we have one drug and we say that yes, this is the drug and this is the dose. For Asians, this is the same drug and this is the same dose for the Europeans, and this is the same dose and the same drugs for the Africans. So we say that the conventional development approach is one size fits all approach. This can be improved. How this can be improved? Now let us see. By giving the right drug at right dose to the right patient at right time. Perhaps what is the most important thing here is the right patient, because we hardly have thought about this, that right patient, because each individual has a different genetic constitution. Patient specific selection of medication and their doses, that is, and the new tool to achieve this is obviously pharmacogenomics. So if we know that there are individual variations which are there, individually the genes differ, and that's why we all are different. So, if we all are different, our metabolic capacities, our absorption capacities are different. So, if that is so, then we might be needing different drugs, or might be needing that same drug in different doses to get the maximum benefit out of it. So, pharmacogenomics holds the promise that drug might be one day tailored made for the individuals and adapted to each person's own genetic makeup. environment, diet, age, lifestyle, and state of health all can influence person's response to medicines. But understanding an individual's genetic makeup, that is what is important, that you have to understand the genetic makeup for it is efficacy and the safety of the drug. This is just a timeline that we have depicted, that how this pharmacogenomics overall developed. We will not go through the whole timeline, but some landmarks are important. Vogel coins the term pharmacogenetics in 1959. This is one of the important things which is there, and where it all began. From here, the term pharmacogenetics, pharmacogenomics became very common. But where it had begun? It had begun way back in 1866, when Georg Gregor Mendel established the rules of hereditary. Obviously, he worked with Pisum sativum, that is the garden pea plants. But yes, the genetic principles, most of his genetics principles still holds true and can be extrapolated even to the humans. And the Indian system of medicine, that is Ayurveda, has thought about it thousands of years back. Though they did not term it as pharmacogenomics, or they were not knowing about the genes and other things, but they knew something which they called it as Prakruti. And according to Prakruti, they classify the patients or the individuals into different Prakrutis, and the same drug is given in different doses to those who are of different Prakruti. Maybe some different drugs are also given, saying that one drug acts well in one Prakruti and it will not act well in the other. And this is something which is very close to the genomics. The only thing is that it takes into consideration the phenotype and not the genotype. And what we are speaking here is about the genotype. So let us see what are the basic concepts here. Let us see this human genome. So we have 22 chromosomes, we know, and one pair of sex chromosomes. So 22 chromosome pairs, that is 44, plus one pair, that is so total 46 chromosomes. Functional unit of the genome is gene. So genome consists of number of genes. 2% of genes code for proteins. Remainder is just structural DNA. Out of that, what is there? Only 2% code for the proteins. Entire genome has about 3 billion DNA pairs with about 30,000 protein coding genes. That is what, and day by day we are adding to this particular knowledge of ours. And this is something which is being schematically shown: 22 pairs and one pair of what? Sex chromosomes, and then gene. What we call it as gene? Gene is a part of DNA which codes for a particular protein, which is responsible for a particular character. So that is what the gene is. You can see here, that is, we have the mRNA introns and exons, where introns are removed and exons come together to form the matured RNA which is there. Now what is allele? Allele codes for a gene. Different alleles determine different characteristics. An allele is one member of the pair that makes up a gene. So gene, one paternal, one maternal, and that is called as alleles. Alleles are like brothers or sisters which are staying what? Together. Two same alleles are homozygous if the two alleles, which are one on maternal, other is paternal, are same, then homozygous. Two different alleles are called as the heterozygous. So we have homozygosity and we have heterozygosity as well. So here it is, the alleles are there, and these are the loci which are present on the individual chromosome. You can just appreciate what is the homozygosity and what is the heterozygosity. Now see, the DNA sequence of all human beings is 99.9% identical. That's why we look like human beings. We don't look like somebody is looking like dog, cat. It is not like that. We all are looking like human beings, because 99.9% our genome, our DNA sequence are same. But we are different also. We can recognize different individuals, and have different characters, physically we are different, psychologically we are different, and that difference arises only out of the difference of 0.1%. So our DNA differs by 0.1%. Does that make a difference? A lot of difference that makes. That makes our personalities different. 0.1% difference translates into 3 million separate spelling differences in the genome of 3 billion bases. And that's why if you give the same drug number of individuals, they may not show the same effect. Answer lies here in that 0.1% difference in our DNA. What is genetic polymorphism? Now let us see. If we want to understand pharmacogenomics, we have to understand what is genetic polymorphism. Let us see what is genetic polymorphism. Genetic polymorphism is any mutant or variant gene that occurs in the frequency of more than 1% in normal population. If in a normal population that gene is occurring for more than 1%, we call it as genetic polymorphism, means genetic difference. It is denoted by a star. Now let us see ahead. Polymorphism can be due to different reasons in the genes. What is the first one is SNP, called as single nucleotide polymorphisms. There can be insertions, there can be even deletions of the chromosomes. SNPs are agar missense, nonsense and silent and frameshift. Insertions are missense, nonsense, frameshift. Deletions, missense, nonsense, frameshift. Let us go quickly and see that what is SNP. What is important here to understand when we want to understand the pharmacogenomics is the SNP, because most of the work revolves around the SNP. SNP is called single nucleotide polymorphism. Now, it is common that there are single nucleotide polymorphisms. Suppose the sequence is like this, G, G, T, A, A, C, T, T, G. That's okay. Suppose in that sequence, T is replaced by C. Then what we will call it as single nucleotide polymorphism. So generally we have this sequence, in one of the subjects T is replaced by just C, we call it as single nucleotide polymorphism. Now see here, here is a single nucleotide polymorphism, this is the normal, this is the normal C. From this particular DNA we have development of mRNA, and from mRNA there is the development of or the synthesis of various amino acids, they are attached together to form a protein, and protein gives a particular character to the human body, a particular human function. So this is a normal, this is a normal thing. What happens in the case of missense? See, everything remains normal, but just this C is replaced by what? T in our body. If this C is replaced by T, mRNA, there will be A, and there will be a missense. In place of GLY glycine, we will have what? The serine as the amino acid, and this amino acid sequence will differ, the character will differ. Nonsense mutation. Now here suppose we have, this is something which is normal. Here if this T is replaced by A, then in the case of mRNA we will have U, and the triplet that will be there is UAG, and we know that UAG is a stop codon. Now see, only one thing that is being changed in the place of the thymine. In the place of thymine there is adenine which is there. So what is happening? This chain gets blocked here only. Only methionine is formed and the chain gets stopped. So nonsense mutations are there. Frame shift mutations, right? Suppose there is a frame shift mutation, there is a deletion of a particular part. Suppose this A gets deleted, then the frames get shift. That is, instead of phenylalanine, we have leucine, and then glycine, we have alanine here. So that is called as frame shift. The frame gets a shift, and that frame shift, because of the frame shift, the triplets that are being read are also shifted in that manner, and that is what is frame shift. All are single nucleotide polymorphism. This is deletion. Can you see here? This particular thing is the chromosome. One part of the chromosome is deleted altogether. So this is after deletion. Duplication, right? So this is one chromosome this particular thing gets duplicated, and this is what is after the duplication. So this is what happens, that is after the duplication there is the another duplicated area that is being formed on the chromosome, probably which is the most important. It is single nucleotide polymorphism which is more important. Probably they differ from each other because of the single nucleotide polymorphisms which are there. So this is an SNP which we already have discussed, that we all are humans but we all are different, and it is similarly it is true in other animals also. Two cheeks are being shown, though we see that they are quite similar, but they differ also. Why they differ? Because there is single nucleotide polymorphism in them as well. So single nucleotide polymorphism, how we can define that? Slowly we are moving towards the pharmacogenomic aspects of it. One type of difference in the DNA between the is SNPs, pronounced as SNPs, are the DNA sequence variations that occur when a single nucleotide A, T, C, G or in the genome is changed, producing what? Different alleles. We have one example quoted. Common SNP only have two alleles, for example A, T, C, G, and here A, T, C, this G is replaced by A. So we have two alleles, G and A. Now here, now coming to the pharmacology as such, now core pharmacology we are moving into. What is the consequence of polymorphism? What are the consequences of polymorphism? These single nucleotide SNPs, polymorphism, what happens? There is disease susceptibility, drug metabolism is affected, drug transport is affected, receptor sensitivity is affected, responders, non-responders are developed, and there are ADRs which are there. One by one we will see all. Now coming to, we starting from here, that is disease susceptibility, and then we will go clockwise. Disease susceptibility. Now see here, hypertension, polymorphism, gene AGT gene where M is replaced by T M235, and this is what this leads to. These patients are more prone to hypertension. AT1R gene where A at 1166 position is replaced by C, increased risk. Again atherosclerosis, again we have increased risk due to the SNPs which are being formed. I am not going through all these things which are being depicted in the table, but yes, that is being proved. Due to the SNPs, some of us are more sensitive, prone towards hypertension, development of atherosclerosis, sometimes they run in families as well. Similarly, it is true for acute myocardial infarctions, Alzheimer's disease, and even cancer susceptibilities are also there due to the single nucleotide polymorphism. So disease susceptibility, why we say that some people are prone to developing the things and some people not, it is probably because of the single nucleotide polymorphism. Coming to the drug metabolism, how the drug metabolism, you delete a gene for metabolism of the drug, there will not be any enzyme and there will not be any metabolism. Then if you make some changes here, SNP, there might be unstable enzyme, reduced metabolism. Normal enzyme, we know most of the population, they will be having the normal enzyme, normal metabolizers. Altered substance specificity, other metabolites possibly are formed, and suppose there is a duplication, then more and more enzyme is formed. If more and more enzyme is formed, increased metabolism is there. So your drug will be finished very quickly from the body, and if it is a prodrug, then it will be developing very quickly into the active drug in your body. So that is how the things. So polymorphic effect of the drug action. So if both are normal, we have this drug concentration. If one is mutant, we have this drug concentration. If both are mutant, we have this drug concentration. So the drug area under curve is increasing. Polymorphism in drug metabolizing enzyme results in increased circulating drug concentrations. So here the enzymes are less and less formed, and that's why there is increase in the drug concentrations which are there. Coming to this concept of CYP450 enzymes, what do we mean? We are on enzymes, that's why we are seeing CYP cytochrome P450 enzymes. these are the enzymes which are most important in our body for metabolism of drugs. So cytochrome P450 enzymes. So we have cytochrome P450 enzymes, and there are various CYP enzymes. One of the example given, CYP2C9*2. So this is the *2 allele, means there is a some SNP and some different type of the things are being formed. CYP P450 for all mammalian species, 450 nanometers, that is what the things are there for all mammalian species. 2 is family, for humans it is 7 to 14 in humans. C is subfamily, 42 in humans. 9 is the enzyme or the genes, 55 genes, and 2 is allelic pattern, *2 allele, right, allelic pattern. What is this *2? That is allelic patterns. So we have here, now here, right, so just a minute, right. So we have here the set of chromosomes, and where is this CYP2C9 is situated? On the 10th pair of chromosome. Can you see here the 10th pair of chromosome? Yes. So on the 10th pair of chromosome it is being situated. In the 10th pair of chromosome, where it is situated, see its position, 242nd position, CYP, right, it one is paternal and one is maternal, CYP2C9 and CYP2C9, they are situated here, these genes are situated here. And here in this case we have exon and introns. We know that introns they do not have any function, but exons they do have. So in exon number 3 in this CYP2C9*1 means normal, in exon 3 we have the nucleotide 430th nucleotide as CTCGT, and it leads to arginine, normal enzyme activity. That is, arginine is a amino acid and normal enzymatic activity. But if we replace C by T, can you see here? Just see, everything is remaining normal, just C is replaced by T. So we have the different amino acid here as compared to the arginine, and we call it as what? CYP2C9*2. Now this is *2, because it is differing and it is more than 1% in a population. What is happening here? Because of that, there is reduced enzymatic activity, the drug will be reduced and metabolism, and there will be increase in the area under curve. See what has happened, just only one SNP has occurred, that in place of C at the CYP nucleotide 430 we had T, and because of that the person became a poor metabolizer, has reduced enzymatic activity, so it will require lesser of a dose of a drug. So that is how the things are. What does CYPs do? Drug metabolism through the body, obviously they activate the drug. If the drug is a prodrug, we know the concept of prodrug, it is inactive drug which has to be getting activated. Detoxify substances and activate non-toxic substances into the toxic substance, this is another thing which is there. Primary CYP in the drug metabolism, CYP1A2C9, which is the most important here perhaps, is 2C9, 2C19 and even 3A4 and 3A5, these are important because the drug metabolized, as you can see, 5, 19, 24 here, and 51 drugs we know of 3A4 and 5 which gets metabolized by this particular pathway. The portion of the drugs metabolized by CYP enzymes, CYP, can you see here, CYP3A4 5, about 36% of the known drugs these are getting. So if there is something wrong in this, there is some SNP in this, then we will have to change the dosing schedule, pattern, doses of the drugs. Mutant alleles of the phase 1 enzymes, right, so CYP2C9*1, how many alleles are known? *2, *3, *4, *5, *6, and these go on increasing, there is each day there is a new knowledge added to this. Probably if today we might be having some *7, *8, *9, and it is changing very fast. So we should have a very much latest knowledge of the things, that how many of the varieties, mutant alleles are there. Substances that are being metabolized, CYP2C9*1, warfarin, then losartan, phenytoin, then tolbutamide, etc. And other drugs are being written here. Red, what do you mean by red? Red absent. Blue is what? Reduced enzyme. And green is what? Increased activity. So if we have CYP2C19 star 1, star 2, star 3, star 4, star 5, star 7 and star 8, they show absent activity of the activity of the enzyme is absent. In blue, the activity of enzyme is reduced, and green, they say increased activity, rapid metabolizers. Then here we will have to increase the dose rather than decreasing it. Phase 2 conjugate enzymes can also be polymorphic. It is not only just CYP enzymes, but also like UDP, glucuronyl transferases, glutathione S transferase, or epoxide hydrolases. These also can have their conjugates or their polymorphs, they can also have. Phase 2 enzymes you can see here, and you can see the substrates which are there for these phase 2 enzymes. CYP2D6 implicates for the poor metabolizers. Decreased elimination of the patient compared to beta blockers metoprolol, decreased prodrug activity, etc. That will happen whenever we have some problem with this particular CYP. Now see here, this is what happens at the grassroots level. In the case of CYP2D6, starting dose nortriptyline, we have normal CYP2D6, we have say 150 milligram per day. We have mutant CYP2D6, we have 10 to 20 milligram per day. So the dosing has changed. In the genotype CYP2C9 star 1 star 1, mean dose of phenytoin, here is phenytoin 314. If we have star 1 star 2, means pattern star 1, tunnel star 2, then 193. If we have star 2 star 3, then we have the dose of 150 milligram. The source is from Pharmacogenetics 2001. Why diazepam metabolism is slower in Asians as compared to Caucasians? Because of this, because Asians have high frequency of mutant CYP2C19. So genotype EM we have star 1 star 1, PM we have star 2 star 2, and diazepam half life you can see here is 20 hours, while you can see here it is what, 84 hours. So that is how the things are. In the case of, now this is H. pylori, CYP2C19 and a treatment of H. pylori. Now see the thing, omeprazole daily and amoxicillin 2 gram per day. This is the treatment regime that we used. Wild type, if we have CYP2C19 star 1 star 1 means normal, cure rate is 29%. HTZ mutant where we have star 1 and again is star 2, 60%. But if we have HMZ mutant, that is star 2 and star 2, the cure rate is 100% due to what? Higher concentration of omeprazole. In these mutants where these CYP are present, then the metabolism of omeprazole is very less. And that's why more and more omeprazole remains our body for the action. And that's why cure rate here is 100%. So if we have CYP2C19 star 2 star 2 and the person is suffering from H. pylori, there is rather good chances that the patient will be cured. Potential consequence of polymorphic drug metabolism, extended pharmacological effects, adverse reactions, lack of prodrug actuation, toxicity, and increased effective dose. So we had seen drug metabolism, we had seen drug susceptibility, drug metabolism, now going to the drug transport. How the drug transport? P-glycoprotein, one of the very important glycoprotein. See, drug transport means transport of the drug inside the cell as well as the transfer of the drug outside, influx and efflux. What does the P-glycoprotein does? It causes efflux. You send the drug inside the cell, P-glycoprotein will send it outside. So if we have the genes which make the P-glycoprotein very prominent and its action very prominent, then more and more of our drug will be sent out of the cell and less drug will be available for the action, we will have to increase the dose. So organic and transport, organic cation transport, etc. What is the importance here we have given is that of to the P glycoprotein. This is how inside and outside, and it is how the efflux takes place outside using the P glycoprotein. The human MDR1 encodes for a membrane P glycoprotein that mediates ATP dependent efflux. Multi-drug resistant one, what is that? The person is resistant to multiple drugs. Why? Because it has this gene MDR1. What does it does? What does it do? It increases the action of P glycoprotein, and because of that, less and less drug is there in the cell for the action, and that's why there will be multi-drug resistance. So that is the explanation for this. Expressions of P glycoprotein are different in different tissues. They are present in the intestine, they are present in the urinary tract, they are present in the interstitial spaces, vascular spaces, they are present everywhere. Evidence obtained by animal studies, P glycoprotein localized in the small intestine and liver suggests a significant role in the oral bioavailability of the drug. Many drug-drug interactions related to inhibition and inducers of P glycoprotein. It is not only just inducing the P glycoprotein. There are certain drugs which might inhibit the P glycoprotein. If the P glycoprotein is inhibited, more and more drugs will remain inside the cell for a longer and longer duration of time. There will be possibility of toxicity. For examples are digoxin, verapamil and rifampicin. So these are the drugs which are there. So MDR genes codes for P glycoprotein, anti-cancer agents, cardiac drugs, HIV protease inhibitors. So these are the substrates for P glycoprotein. So ritonavir is a substrate for P glycoprotein. It will make the efflux of that drug when it enters the cell. MDR polymorphism and disease. So if we have MDR polymorphism, may alter the physiologic and protective role of P glycoprotein, and we are associated with the disease like Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, epilepsy and other diseases as well. We have seen drug transport. Now coming to the next thing, that is receptor sensitivity. Receptor sensitivity, we know that there are various receptors in our body. No need to go into details of that. We know beta receptors, alpha receptors, etc. Say 5-HT receptors. But their sensitivity is quite different at different times, because their structure is somewhat getting different because of the SNPs which are there. So we have beta 1 receptor gene, beta 2 receptor genes, sensitivity and efficacy. If glycine at 389 is being replaced, then reduce sensitivity to the beta blockers which we have here. So we have single nucleotide polymorphism playing role here also. That is, if there is a single nucleotide polymorphism, one amino acid will be replaced by other. Your structure of the receptor will change a bit, and that's why its sensitivity will also change a bit. It will not respond that effectively to the blockers or stimulator drugs. That is what it wants to say. Then responders and non-responders all together, we will see that some of the patients respond to some drug, some of the patients will not respond to the drugs. Why? We have asthma and we have certain gene ALOX5. These respond poorly to anti-leukotriene treatment. Atherosclerosis, CETP, poor response to the treatment with parvastatin. So all these things which are very much correlated, we know, if we know that certain genes are present and these are non-responders, then probably we will not give those drugs to those patients and waste our time which they will not respond to. Finally, we had started from here, disease susceptibility, drug metabolism, drug transport, receptor sensitivity, responder, non-responders, and finally we will go to adverse drug reactions, ADR. Here is one typical adverse drug reactions of phenytoin toxicity, that is gingival hyperplasia. If we have the genotype CYP2C9*3*3 on one gene, star 3 on another gene, then such a person is very much susceptible for development of gingival hyperplasia. You can see the gingival hyperplasia in such patients, and it is proved beyond doubt. So if you know the genotype of the patient, you will either not use this drug or use this drug in lesser doses to prevent such a type of the adverse drug reactions which are being shown. So this girl not only will be susceptible for toxicity towards the phenytoin, but also for warfarin, losartan, then ibuprofen, flubiprofen and diclofenac, etc. All mediated, because these all are mediated by cytochrome P2C, CYP2C9 enzyme. So subjects who are carriers of at least one mutant STAR2, STAR3 are 4 times more susceptible to bleeding complications in spite of low dose of administration of what? Warfarin, another example of this particular thing. Now coming to the pharmacogenomics and drug development, we have seen, though not in very much details, but yes, we have taken a bit of everything and we have seen that how the genetics, how the SNPs, they influence various aspects of the drugs and their actions. Now coming to the drug development. Now see one scenario. An investigative drug saw no statistically significant effect when given to 400 Alzheimer's patients. They have given this drug to 400 Alzheimer's patients, statistically no significant effect. So almost the drug is of no use. The drug should not reach the market. But the clinically significant response was obtained when the patients were stratified according to ApoE subtype of the genes. Now see the things. The drug here is tacrine. When it is given to the population, it did not, without them being analyzed for the genetic constitution, there is no statistical significance and it says that drug is of no use. But when the population is segregated into ApoE1, ApoE2, ApoE3 and ApoE4, what we see, stratify the patient according to the genotypes, and what we see that for ApoE1, ApoE2 and ApoE3, tacrine, there is no statistical significant response, but in the case of ApoE4, tacrine shows statistical. So I can say that tacrine is the drug which is made for the individuals with ApoE4. They are not made for the individuals with ApoE1, 2 or 3. So here we save a drug. So if you have the genetic constitution, ApoE1, 2, 3, no need to give tacrine, but yes, if you have 4, it will work very fine in such patients. So preclinical gene expressions like toxicogenomics is another thing which is there, predicting the toxicity, identify the potential biomarkers, etc. In phase 1 studies also, explain the outsiders, patients' variability in PK might be due to the genetic variations, there is a PK variability. So we will exclude or include the patient, and we can even normalize their gene frequencies during the phase 1 studies. Even phase 2 and phase 3 studies, we have just now seen that should incorporate the genetic makeup of the individual in it. Otherwise, very good drugs, they will be what? They will go away from our hands. They will not hit the market. Let the drug come into market and let this particular thing be explained, that this drug is for this particular genetic constitution. So what are the anticipated benefits? Pharmaceutical companies will be enabled to create the drug based on the proteins, enzymes and RNA, etc. This will facilitate the drug discovery and allow the drug makers to produce the therapy more targeted towards what? Specific disease, where we can increase the efficacy of the drug and decrease its toxicity. That is very important. Better and for the first time, more accurate methods of determining appropriate drug doses and advanced screening techniques. Appropriate drug doses, yes, depending on the genetic constitutions. Improvements in the drug discovery and overall cost will also be decreased. But there are some ethical issues always facing to us, that will we be discovering the drugs only with a for a particular genetic makeup of patients? Could the development of medicines for a specific group of the population exclude others? Will the development of unprofitable but desirable medicine neglected? Who will have the access to the genetic information? All these things can be tackled very in their own way. Research issues, narrower target population, evaluating therapies in smaller targeted population to show the statistical significance, that may also be there. social issues. Patient might ask the questions like this: will I develop this disease years from now? Do I want to know my susceptibility to this incurable disease? And final question is very important. It says, one of the patient asks, can I indulge in unhealthy habits like smoking, junk food, if I don't have a particular disease susceptibility? I don't have this particular susceptibility gene. So, can I just drink, smoke and make merry without having this particular disease? Such a type of questions may arise. So, that is something what we want to discover. How the discovery will be there in the future? Patient requires treatment, means treatment will be there in the future. Patient requires treatment, examination by physicians, genetic testing, traditional investigations will go. Then both will combine, expert system, decision making by physician, assisted by expert system, and particular drug will be given in the particular doses to the individual. And this is something which we did ourselves, that is isolating our own DNA. This is myself and this this is the DNA, this is my DNA which I isolated from the body fluid, that is from blood. And such a types of, it is not very far, such a types of the laboratories are coming very fast, which will give you your genetic makeup, for which especially of CYP enzymes at least. And we have breakthrough in the form of the polymerase chain reaction, PCR machines and other things which can make the copies of the required genes in a short duration of time. And we have in 2003 Roche already launched a diagnostic, launches the AmpliChip CYP415 US, the world's first pharmacogenomic microarray for clinical applications. So, microarray technique will tell you very, very quickly as to what is your genetic makeup, as especially even for your CYP enzyme. What will be the future? As we have different cards with us, we might be having our genomic card with us, and it will show us the genetic makeup and show us very clearly as to which drug we are susceptible to, for which drugs we are non-responders, for which drugs we are good metabolizers or the poor metabolizers. So, here is my sequence and Dr. is saying, oh, she is a poor metabolizer. So, this is the future of the medicine which is there. So, thank you very much for your patient listening. So, this is how what we have gone through. It is just a tip of the iceberg of what the pharmacogenomics is. And this pharmacogenomics definitely will alter the methodicity of the treatment in the near future. Thank you all for your patient listening. Namaste and thank you.